Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. It's our pleasure tonight to be, to present our cases tonight. Unfortunately, we're supposed to have 3 cases, but 1 case was not done yet. So probably we'll go with the other 2 cases. At the end of this meeting, inshallah, I think the company, they need some 10 minutes to present some new data about their new product. And the first case will be presented by our fellow, Abdurrahman. You can start, I will not talk about the case.
We'll open again. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. We have 2 cases. First case, this is 70 years old, Saudi gentleman. Known case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and chronic kidney disease with peptic ulcer disease. Came to our hospital complaining of severe abdominal pain, mainly in the right iliac fossa and subarachnoid area, graded about 7 over 10 according to the severity of the pain, associated with rectal bleeding for the last 3 days. This patient also have a history of cancer prostate, resected before 4 years and treated and followed by radiotherapy. By examination, the vitae for this patient is stable. His conscious, alert, oriented, time, place, person. Blood pressure is 120 over 80. The pulse is 86 regular per minute. Afebrile and oxygen saturation is 100 room air. Generally, the patient looks pale. The chest examination have harsh vesicular breathing with no additional sound. The heart is 1, is 2, plus 0. The abdomen, there is tenderness in the lower abdomen and right iliac fossa with negative rebound and no guarding or rigidity and no organomegaly or lymphadenopathy. BR examination, there is fresh blood coming from the rectum. So, what is the differential diagnosis?
Any comment from the audience? They would like to comment about the possible differential. Yeah, Malid.
In examination, not as severe abdominal pain. So, mesenteric bowel ischemia and higher in the list. So, with fresh rectal bleeding in this age with diabetes, this possibility. Other differential diagnosis, the patient, he has prostatic cancer. So, possibility of prostatic cancer metastasis to the bowel, this likely have bleeding and obstruction and obstruction possibility. He received radiation therapy. Radiation therapy can make, even after years, radiation induced enteritis or colitis are making bleeding and make another differential diagnosis.
Yeah, and there and is a common differential diagnosis at this age.
Hemorrhoids, different, but abdominal pain usually is ischemic bowel, ischemic colitis in the first list.
Did he have any history of radiotherapy?
Radiotherapy? Yes, given before.
I said radiation therapy can induce enteritis and bleeding.
What about the diverticular
To make abdominal pain, diverticular bleeding usually painless.
No,
it is possible if there's diverticulitis, it's less likely.
Anyway.
It's a possibility, yes. We can make it.
And the pain was, according to the presentation, was quite severe. It's 7
yes,
out
7
of 10.
Over 10, yes.
Yes. So the pain is severe, but examination.
And this comes with diverticulitis, plus minus diverticular bleeding per se.
Usually, rarely come two together. Diverticulitis, diverticular bleeding, two together, rarely to come two together. Either the patient has segmental colitis due to diverticular disease with bleeding, is a possibility.
How common ischemic colitis will present with fresh rectal bleed?
It's common.
Unless it is the patient's quite sick and the abdominal examination is quite clear that the patient is having something
serious.
Serious.
Yes.
But low flow ischemic colitis, usually the pain is more than the rectal bleeding.
Different infection can cause this abdominal pain with bleeding, but this severe pain is likely.
Okay.
Difficile infection possibility.
For diabetes and hypertension, and possibly he's an aspirin as well, is it?
Yes.
So any maybe ulcers, like if there is any large ulcer can cause pain and even small bowel ulceration. I agree with Dr. Mahrous, that maybe ischemia in this presentation, elderly with comorbidities. I agree, maybe it will be number one, the differential diagnosis. It is painful bleeding, rectal bleeding, with right leg fossa pain. I think of ischemia. Usually the ischemia on the left side, but around 20% will present in the right colon. And usually, actually, the prognosis is much poor in those patients who have right-sided colitis, ischemic colitis. Anyone would like to add to the differential diagnosis?
I mean, may consider IBD, especially Crohn's disease. I mean, if you have bleeding or something, more than you see in the
scenario. At age of 70, it's not that common. This, but anyway, anything is possible. But the age is 70 plus.
70 years, 71.
He's 70 plus, 75.
Yeah, I mean, this is the second peak for Crohn's disease. I mean, it can come in early age. And
usually it is by models that between age 50 and unlikely to be age 70 or 80s. I don't know. Someone can correct me.
Huh? Crohn's disease. Isn't that a common manifestation of Crohn's GI bleeding? Yeah, lower GI bleeding.
Maybe you go with the pain. Sometimes. Ulcerate. Yeah, most likely is common. Ischemia plus minus that particular disease. Okay, what else, Abdurrahman?
We can add a differential diagnosis for this patient.
Malignancies with obstruction,
yes,
or something.
Our impression about the differential diagnosis, this is, as Dr. Walid said, and audience, mesenteric vascular ischemia, one of the differential diagnoses. Ischemic colitis secondary to radiation before. Diverticulosis and angio dysplasia and cancer colon. Especially this patient have two risk factors, have chronic renal failure, chronic renal impairment. So angio dysplasia is common in this type of patient. And cancer colon, because the patient have a history of prostate cancer, maybe a metastasis also.
But angio dysplasia is usually painful, I mean painless. I mean, it should not give you pain. I mean, in this patient particularly. I mean, so it's probably very remote in this list. Mm.
I mean, apart from the pain that he has presented, the main presentation was rectal bleeding. And I think this is the second episode, or he had it frequently in the past. Angiodysplasia, considering his age, is still common and possible as a differential. Usually, the constitution and symptoms in such patients will be more prominent than you are talking about acute presentation of rectal bleeding and acute pain. TB, it's still there, I mean, in all our differential, but the symptoms, the background of the patient doesn't look like. No.
Because he restarted.
Yeah, he's not. Any more comments?
Well, you know, he's pain, he's pain, and he's an old man.
I mean, it's possible, but if we are talking about rectal bleeding as hematochezia causes by upper GI bleeding, the patient will be a bit not quite stable as he was in his initial presentation. But I mean, still, there is some possibility. No more comments? What's your work, Abi Abdurrahman?
Yes. We decided to do a routine lab for the patient and CT abdomen and upper and lower endoscopy for the patient. Actually, the routine lab for the patient, the CBC came for the patient, the hemoglobin is 82 on the lower side, and the ESR is only 23, no leukocytosis. The creatinine on the higher side, 172, because the patient have known chronic renal impairment. And the liver function is normal.
So based on this picture, I mean, you Based on this, you can roll out initial inflammatory process.
Yes.
I mean, considering the inflammatory markers and basically.
The coagulation is good for the patient. Yes, around 11 or 10.5.
And we know that he has recurrent rectal bleeding in the past, right?
The previous one was 4 months.
Huh?
The previous one was 4 months prior to this.
Prior to this presentation, yes. طيب.
This is the T for the CT abdomen for the patient. Here there is a thickening in the terminal ileum, also in the bowel lobe, especially in the ascending colon and the cecal area.
What does it mean?
Inflammation or inflammatory bowel disease or infection also can give the same picture of thickening of the terminal ileum and the ascending colon.
Yeah, inflammatory process, okay.
Yes. This is the report of the CT, the same as significant long segment of bowel thickening in bone distal ileum and distal ascending colon associated with mesenteric fat stranding, but ruled out nematosis intestinalis or bowel dilatation or any sign of perforation. This segment of demonstrate unremarkable mucosal, didn't take the dye, the contrast. So our impression is inflammation or infection or mesenteric panniculitis and ischemia also in this age. We prepare the patient for upper endoscopy. The result came mild antral gastritis and multiple nodular lesion in the first part of the duodenum.
For the audience, do you agree to start with, to go with upper endoscopy in this patient?
I would disagree with this one myself. The upper, there was no indication for the upper endoscopy. The other thing for mesenteric panniculitis and the differential, it doesn't fit. Usually it's in the mesentery and it doesn't affect the bowels itself. So it should not be listed in the differential in the CT scan. So the upper endoscopy.
This differential was raised by the radiologist.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it should. I mean, it's usually limited to the mesentery. Basically, it doesn't affect the small bowels, and the upper endoscopy. I don't see room for it to fit in. So I mean, I don't know why it was done. So. But the patient was really stable. I mean, hemodynamics stable and.
I agree. I mean, it has no point. But maybe because of the patient, was VIB anyway.
Oh, okay, and, that's fine. We'll forget it.
Part of it. We might need it at one time. So if you think we might need upper endoscopy and the patient is going for colonoscopy.
We're talking just because
I do it this way.
Our colleagues, the
but
fellows
but clinically
here,
indicated for his case, no, it's not the first choice or the first thing to be done. Maybe Dr. Abed, he has comment. To take it logic, regardless.
I'll go for upper endoscopy because the patient has peptic ulcer disease, he has unexplained abdominal pain, and hematochezia. I should start with the upper endoscopy.
But we know the presentation mainly is colonic. The pain is quite lower abdominal pain, and the bleeding is rectal. It is there, but it's not a priority anyway. To make it logic, خلاص. yes. Huh? Anyway, regardless, it is done.
It's the same
thing. First or second, it's not that big issue.
The same thing.
Anyway, it's negative, okay?
Yes.
What else?
Huh? Yes, there is a nodular lesion in the first part of the duodenum.
Nodularity in the duodenum. Can we ask the junior if they have? Could you see such pictures in Crohn's disease? Aberrant style in Crohn's? Huh? It's bad. But I mean, looking to the mucosa, it's not erythematous, it's not acutely inflamed. Biopsy taken? Yalla Abdurrahman.
This is a picture of the colonoscopy on the same setting also. We did colonoscopy.
The whole colonic mucosa is coated with blood all through. From the rectum, spared slightly the sigmoid, and spared slightly the descending colon, and then the transverse ascending colon all full with blood. On cleaning, we can see some lesion. This after cleaning, this is ascending colon, yeah.
This is the mucosa of the ascending colon.
It's just oozing blood.
And this is quite clear, huh? And involving the whole colon, left and right.
Yeah, but more on the right side.
More on the right side.
Yeah. You can see. No. It was just blood, all the area. This was very difficult to go to the TI. No, because of the blood. Yeah. No, this is just angiodysplasia.
Diffuse, the whole colon is involved.
Multiple mucosal angiodysplasia, mainly on the right side of the colon.
And all through the colon, mainly on the cecum and ascending colon. We'll go back to the lesion, the duodenum. This lesion, when we took the first biopsy, they mentioned that there is no duodenal mucosa. They comment that it is gastric mucosa. So it was labeled as heterotropia. But we repeat the endoscopy again, and we insist that this biopsy from the duodenum. So it came back to be gastric
heterotropia.
I shift by the talabar endoscopy, Ibrahim. Okay. We can go with the case now. What has been done, Abdurrahman?
This is a biopsy, result of multiple fragment of antral type gastric mucosa and body type, no duodenal biopsy. This is the comment of the histopathology, but we repeated again and it came with gastric heterotropia from the duodenum. Regarding the ascending colonic mucosa, tiny superficial adenomatous polyp, but it is negative for malignancy. So now what is the next step for?
It's quite diffuse angiodysplasia. The whole colon, it's actively bleeding or oozing blood. What you should do?
No, before that, we have to see the specimen testing. Maybe there is some more lesion.
We couldn't go anyway. We are talking about this now. And endoscopically, the patient is in front of you on the table. What you should do? We have capsule endoscopy.
Yeah, we did the capsule after treatment. So,
the pain was not explained, but you don't know was we can't explain the pain. But I mean, the bleeding is can be explained with this diffuse that was oozing blood.
Yeah, right. It's still the
technique.
And. For the sickening.
And biochemically, there is nothing suggestive of inflammation. I mean, SR is normal, CRB was normal. The inflammatory markers was normal.
The CT,
they said thickening.
I think the possibility of
could
radiation.
Could be, I don't know.
Radiation-induced enterocolitis is still a high possibility. Yeah. Because all the inflammatory markers are negative, so it's radiation-induced enterocolitis.
Yeah, you can.
4 years ago. Yeah, it can happen at any time.
Yeah.
What's strange, the pain persists only for 2-3 days and
the resolved. The pain was acutely and it's relieved. Anyway.
But again.
Now we are left now with this. Something that explains his rectal bleeding and clinically, I mean, endoscopically, there is bleeding is going on in the patient. It's oozing, the whole colon was oozing. So what you should do? Expert.
So perfusion and probably use thalidomide in this gentleman. I would use thalidomide as an anti-angiogenic.
What else? Should you go for endoscopic intervention in such patients?
Well, you said the whole colon is covered and there's a lot of blood. I don't know if you're you're going to cook the whole colon, I think. It's not.
Google it.
I will not go, I mean, with.
Hit the problem.
ABC, but I mean to do it in the whole colon. The risk, the risk, even the. I mean, you cannot cover it at least in one session, and and the risk, especially in the right side with a lot of ABCs, is there. I mean, perforation is quite common in such cases. I mean,
I think we need to.
If you're being aggressive to do it, the whole colon.
We need to define the small bowel if there is any angiodysplasia there or not.
Let us deal with what we are seeing.
No. I mean, no, you cannot. I mean,
we'll discuss the small bowel.
What, no, but no,
let
this,
me,
the issue
let me
is
deal
now,
with this, what I'm
no,
seeing.
No,
now, patient is bleeding in front of me.
No,
what should I do?
No, the question is you did not get. You did not define the small bowels if there is AVMs or not. Well, you can do Bush enteroscopy or double balloon or something. I mean, you need to see if there is lesions in the small bowels from above. I mean, you go as far as you can go. If there is AVMs there, then basically you are not dealing with colonic lesions. You are dealing with the small bowels and colonic. In this situation, But you said only from the colon. So, absolutely. So now, yeah. The difference is now, sir, if there's a small bowels, if it is small bowels and colonic, you are not, this is not a surgical case, number two, if this is only colonic now, I mean, and it's not small bowels, you would do conservative or you go with total colectomy, I mean, if the patient is really sanguinating. So I need to define if there is anything in small bowels or not before I decide. But he's hemodynamically not really crashing. I mean, I would probably support him and give thalidomide as an option and then see how it goes, basically.
This is what we did.
Okay.
Yes. As the colleague said, we started the patient on thalidomide.
This is basically after good resuscitation and killing the patient.
Yes. Yes. We repeated the CBC only after starting thalidomide by 3 days. Only the hemoglobin jumping from 82 to 96.
Without any blood transfusion.
Without any blood transfusion. طيب. So we decided to start the patient on thalidomide for at least, supposed to be for 3 months, but we're giving him for 1 month and repeated the colonoscopy again after 1 month.
Okay.
This is a picture of the mucosa after 1 month, mainly the right side and ascending colon.
Only lesion which was persisting there is one lesion in the cecum and another lesion in the ascending colon. There was no active bleeding at all. We did capsule endoscopy and it showed only 2 lesions, mostly in the terminal ileum. There is no after treatment.
Yeah. This is a CBC after 1 month from starting thalidomide. The hemoglobin now is 12.1. So our impression about this patient is angiodysplasia. We will give small review about angiodysplasia.
Yes, echo was normal.
Normal. Angiodysplasia is the first case. The tissue was described on 8033-39, but the term angiodysplasia was first used on 1974. Can be defined as abnormal ectatic dilated tortuous and usually small, less than 10 millimeter blood vessel, visualized within the mucosa and submucosa layer of the gut. The affected vessel aligned by endothelium only with little or no smooth muscle. It is considered as an important cause for the GI blood loss. This is a picture of angiodysplasia in the small bowel by single balloon enteroscopy. The second one, this in B, by colonoscopy. We can classify the gastrointestinal angiodysplasia according to the location, according to the size and the number. Location, it can come in the gastric, duodenum, jejunum, ileal, and colonic. The size, minute, if it is less than 2 millimeter in diameter, intermediate between 2 to 5 millimeter, and large more than 5 millimeter. The number may be one or multiple or diffuse number. Angiodysplasia is often detected in patients older than 60 years. The prevalence is not well known. In colonic screening of about 964 patients in healthy asymptomatic adults, we found the ratio about 0.8% angiodysplasia. There is some condition associated with angiodysplasia. One of them is the chronic renal failure. It is common in patients with chronic renal failure, and the prevalence is said to be related to the duration and severity of the kidney disease. Account about from 19 to 32% of the lower GI episode in patients with chronic renal failure compared to the normal population or general population is 5 to 6. Patient with chronic renal failure has increased risk of bleeding due to several mechanisms. One of them is the uremic platelet dysfunction and the use of anticoagulant. Also, it is associated with aortic stenosis called Heidi syndrome. Bleeding from angiodysplasia improve in most of patients after aortic valve replacement. Also with vulval brand disease, because it is disrupted by high shear stress as the blood passes through the stenotic valve, leading to cleavage and subsequent reduction in high molecular weight multimer causing acquired vulval brand disease. Abnormal vulval brand disease can provide explanation for the increased risk of bleeding in patients with aortic stenosis. This is the pathogenesis. There is a Boyle et al. Suggested that this lesion developed with aging due to chronic low-grade intermittent obstruction of the submucosal vein as a result of increased contractility at the level of the muscularis propria. This will lead to congestion of the capillaries and the failure of the precapillary sphincter, resulting in formation of small arteriovenous collateral. Because the bowel, we know it is cylinder in shape, and according to the law of Laplace, the tension is high when the radius increases and the wall thickness reduces, which apply to the ascending colon and the cecum. So it is common in this area. This is a diagram, arteriovenous collateral between in the mucosa and here in the submucosa. Other theory suggests that the mucosal ischemia from the chronic hypoxia or hypoperfusion due to the underlying cardiac, vascular, pulmonary disease may contribute to the development of angiodysplasia. Angiogenesis is an essential biological process to increase the vascularity in the lumen tissue when there is hypoxia or ischemia, which results in formation of a new vessel named new vascularization, which leads to subsequent development of anti-angiogenetic drugs like thalidomide. This is angiodysplasia in the mucosa and here in the submucosa. What about the clinical manifestation? It is common, a cause of GI bleeding discovered accidentally during the endoscopic evaluation performed for other reason. If the bleeding occurs, the bleeding tend to be recurrent and chronic. The GI bleeding can occur at multiple sites within the GI, including the colon, small bowel, and stomach. Regarding the distribution, it is in the cecum about 37%, ascending colon 17, transverse colon 7, ascending colon 7, and sigmoid is 18, and the rectum is 14%. How we can diagnose the angiodysplasia? Either by the endoscopic imaging, commonly using endoscopic modality to assess the small bowel, including wireless capsule enteroscopy, Bosch enteroscopy, and double balloon or enteroscopy, or single balloon enteroscopy, or intraoperative enteroscopy. The lesion, the mucosa at the lesion margin appear like hollow sign. We can diagnose also by radiologic imaging like radionucleotide scanning or CT angio or MRI angio or standard angio. Radionucleotide scanning used in technetium, used also to localize the bleeding that occur at a rate 0.1 millimeter per minute, but its localization is general and could be anywhere in the abdomen. The accuracy between 24% to 91% among different study. CT and MRI can provide rapid non-invasive diagnosis, but there is concern about the radiation exposure and the allergy to some radiology. The sensitivity of the angio range from 85 to 86, from 58 to 86%. Detection of the bleeding depends on the rate of bleeding as low as the technique and the timing of angiography in relation to the period of bleeding also. It allows accurate localization and therapeutic embolization of the bleeding point to achieve at the same time, and but there is a risk of bowel ischemia. This procedure generally reserved to patients in whom other modality are failed to identify the source of bleeding, or there is severe bleeding and hemodynamic instability. This is the angiography. This is the arterial phase. And here is the collecting venous phase during the vein, a large vein. Vasopressin can be used during the angio infusion to arrest the bleeding, but we know the complication of vasopressin, including the bowel infarction, arterial vasospasm, and low extremity ischemia. Regarding the management of angiodysplasia, we have many modalities, either endoscopic therapy or transcatheter angio and intervention, or superior selective or super selective transcatheter embolization, or surgery or pharmacological therapy. Endoscopic therapy like argon, plasma coagulation, ABC, became the most widely used method for treatment of angiodysplasia. Rebleeding rate between 11 to 19%, mainly result from finding of a new lesion or no serious and with no serious complication. Complication of ABC including cecal perforation, some cases are reported. This is angiodysplasia. We applied the argon here, ABC. We can use also electrocoagulation. This technique is not recommended in current practice because have a high risk of serious complication like perforation and a high rate of free bleeding also. Photocoagulation by laser has been reported in some studies, recent evidence. Using this technique, I'll focus mainly on GAVE, but no serious complication was reported. Endoscopic clips can be used also safely and effect in few cases reporting using endoscopic clips for bleeding in the colon, either as a monotherapy or in combination with thermal ablation using ABC and contact probe. This clipping is useful in isolated and large lesion to obliterate the feeding vessel and reduce the risk of precipitating bleeding from subsequent electrocoagulation. Transcatheter angio and intervention also indicated in patients with active GI bleeding who fail the endoscopic therapy or ABC to achieve stop bleeding. Transcatheter angiography and intervention are considered alternative to the surgery in high-risk patients to localize the lesion prior to the surgery. Control the bleeding can be achieved, but it has some disadvantage like rebleeding and systemic vasoconstriction, which lead to ischemia. And it is also contraindicated in patients with coronary artery disease, severe hypertension, and peripheral vascular disease, and arrhythmia. Super selective transcatheter, this technique is successful also in 80 to 90% of the patient with relative low rebleeding rate. Repeat the embolization can be performed if the bleeding came again. But again, the complication can be hematoma or arterial dissection or thrombosis or pseudoaneurysm formation and bowel infarction. Surgery. Surgical resection is now reserved for the patient with acute severe bleeding not controlled by any alternative method, we said, with recurrent chronic bleeding who are transfusion dependent or frequent admission to the hospital. The surgery is curative because it defines accurate localization of the bleeding lesion preoperative and should be attempted to avoid the recurrence of the bleeding from missing lesion elsewhere in the GI tract. The pharmacological treatment, there is hormonal therapy like estrogen and progesterone in management of patients with diffuse and sporadic bleeding from angiodysplasia, but now no role for the hormonal treatment. Now the main is thalidomide. Thalidomide acting by inhibition of angiogenesis through suppression of the expression of vascular endothelial growth factor. It's effective in the treatment of chronic bleeding from angiodysplasia. Can be demonstrated in many cases published in the last decade. Reduction in the number and the size of angiodysplasia also reported post the therapy. The finding is confirmed by many, or we have three label, open label randomized controlled trial, about 55 patients, either refractory or unstable for other modality. All the patient observed for 1 year regarding the use of thalidomide, 100 milligram BO once daily with iron also for the last 4 months. Response of the treatment defined by decrease the number of bleeding episode and decrease the number of admission and decrease the number of transfusion. The bleeding is stopped in 46 patients receiving thalidomide compared to none of the control group. These benefits are sustained for at least minimum 1 year from the follow-up. But the most common adverse effect of thalidomide, some side effect like fatigue in 80% and 32%, constipation, dizziness, peripheral edema, and abdominal distension. Other rare complications like leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, bradycardia, numbness of the limb, and the headache with tinnitus and rash also with pruritus. But also have a liver toxicity and fulminant hepatic failure in addition to causing birth defect. This is the trial, about 55 patients done for him. The maximum recommended dose for the thalidomide is 100 per day. Octreotide also we can use. The effect of somatostatin analog for the stop of the bleeding have a role by several mechanisms, like inhibition of angiogenesis, by downgrading of vascular endothelial growth factor, increasing the vascular resistance, and decrease the splenic blood flow, and enhance the platelet aggregation. So our conclusion is angiodysplasia is the most common vascular malformation of the GI tract. It is commonly detected in all the patients and located more often in the cecum and ascending colon. The majority of patients have more than one lesion in one or more part of the GI tract. Clinical presentation is a range from asymptomatic or non-bleeding to overt life-threatening hemorrhage also. Association between the increased risk of bleeding of angiodysplasia and aortic stenosis or vulvar brand or coronary renal failure is now more established. Endoscopy is currently the modality of choice to diagnose and the treatment of the lesion. ABC is the most cost-effective endoscopy therapy, while pharmacological treatment like thalidomide and octreotide considered a second line in the treatment of the group. Transcatheter angio with or without intervention is also effective in management of patients with severe bleeding. We have some data about the result, if anyone need to see it. This is the first case.
I think it's nice presentation and nice review.
I repeat again, it shows the same finding. As I mentioned, the first endoscopy and first biopsy, it was misinterpreted as a gastric biopsy. It is not duodenal. So repeat the endoscopy again. It shows the same lesion is there. Gastric heterotropia. So? No inference. No. No, we cannot say like this. And this incident, what happened with us? Yeah, this is what happened, really. After 3 days, no bleeding anymore. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And after 1 month, we repeat the colonoscopy. It was magic. And I was not expecting. Yeah. Even the studies for 3 to 4 months, the treatment.
Then you stopped the urine.
Yeah.
3 months?
Yeah. Now we won't finish 1 month. No, we finish 1 month. Yeah.
But you plan to
Thank you, Dr. Abdurrahman. During review, do you read about Avastin? I think in Faisal there is a case started Avastin. Vascular endothelial, Dr. Khan. Yeah, was excellent, yeah. Excellent.
It's a new research.
It's a vascular endothelial growth factor.
Any comparative studies between octreotide and thalidomide in such cases, or you are not aware about it?
Study of octreotide in hospital is a small study. They give somatostatin usually maybe 50 to 100 microgram initially for twice a day for about 2 weeks, and then after that they give a long-acting octreotide. The result usually, they found that 75% of the patients respond. It is a small study.
Any more questions? We close this case. Well done, Abed, and thank you, Abdurrahman. Last comment, Walid, Fishay.
When the patient failed all medical, surgical, interventional treatment, then you think about thrombolytic treatment.
No, I think the decision here was quite good and excellent. I mean, they didn't go for surgery. Yes. The case was quite difficult to be treated endoscopically. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they didn't know about the small bowel, what's the picture there. So the decision, I think, was excellent.
Yes.
And considering the safety profile of the medication itself, I think it's no harm to, if the patient's quite stable, and hemodynamically, I mean, you can monitor the patient and see. I think it's an excellent decision.
It's a difficult decision.
No need to be very cautious and very scared to use such medication if you have this such result.
Usually patients have an acute bleeding, you need to treat an acute situation as an acute thing. As Dr. Sahibani said, it will take some time. Huh? Intervention and radiology, it is a big choice for this patient. Intervention, embolization, frequent embolization. Usually, angioplasty spontaneous stopping is most common without any bleeding. So during that time, you can go and make multiple ABC. After failure of the ABC, if the patient has still acute bleeding, interfere with the interventional. If the intervention they feel, we call the surgery. These acute things. Thalidomide will take time, usually given for patients who have frequent anemia, chronic loss of blood, for patients with angiodysplasia in multiple places, in small bowel, large bowel. After we fail other medical treatment, like somatostatin, it's more safer. Thalidomide, it is risky medication, a lot of side effects. Even here they said it is, after good discussion with the patient, even in the guidelines, that last choice you think about is thalidomide. This is my opinion, I didn't know.
And you have seen the result is it's quite excellent result, I mean. Even the hemoglobin was raised by itself without any blood transfusion or anything. Yeah, you might think of it. Yeah, Badr, last comment. We'll go move.
Do you use ABC, for example, in this patient?
I mean, for this quite difficult. I mean, for this to, you will stay the whole day just doing the whole colon, and the risk will be for perforation, especially those in the cecum, is quite high. I mean, if you are cauterizing the whole cecum, it's quite difficult, really. I mean, if I have nothing to do medically in this case, I'll take it to the surgery directly. If I cannot manage medically, endoscopy, I think it is not practical at this time. I mean, it's quite difficult. Unless you bring the patient in sessions and do it, depends on the patient, the patient condition and how stable he is. But I mean, if the bleeding is more active and the patient more hemodynamically unstable, I think surgically he should be managed if the radiologists fail to help us. This is what I know, that he has something done in the private for King Faisal, I think. Huh? Huh? Private. But you don't. I mean, in the private is still the private. You are not quite sure what they has done to the patient. Okay. Even they will do one or two. They said, "Khalas, we will manage you," because if they think of complication, they will not be aggressive, as if you are in the hospital. You know. I mean, if you touch it, it will bleed by itself.
And angiodysplasia, if you would like to do ABC, I think there are some papers that are telling that you have to inject the submucosa with ephedrine with normal saline. Inject this, the area behind it, and then you can use ABC. The chances of perforation is going to be very, very low.
We'll take last comments from that my friend there. Ma smak ya waladi.
increase the need for frequency of blood transfusion. So just let's agree that the acute effect that we saw maybe was the natural, that was the natural cause of the AV bleeding, AVM bleeding, rather than the effect of thalidomide. I mean, so it was not the indication to stop the active bleeding or to treat it acutely, right?
Maybe, I don't know, maybe there is some study about octreotide. It can be used as acute treatment in such cases. Tayyip, thank you very much for this case. We'll go for the next case.
The second case is a 47 years old female, Bara 14, asked medical advice in many clinics regarding epigastric pain, recurrent, on and off, treated many times with symptomatic treatment with no improvement. And someone requesting X-ray abdomen for her, and this is the X-ray of the abdomen.
Anybody from the juniors, from the seniors as well? No problem. Do you see anything in the X-ray?
This patient have a history of insertion of intrauterine contraceptive device 20 years ago.
Okay. Anyway, there is a possibility of what, Abdurrahman, to make it?
Yes, the intrauterine conceptive device escape from the uterus to other site. But supposed to be when it will penetrate the uterine wall and go to another site, where it will be go?
Anyway, present the case, then we'll discuss, what's going on, okay?
This is 47 years old female, Bara 14, presented to the clinic with abdominal pain for the last 3 months. Actually, this abdominal pain started before 10 years ago, on and off, visited many places and diagnosed as irritable bowel syndrome and treated with ranitidine and analgesic, but no good improvement. 3 months ago, the pain became continuous and not relieved with this treatment and sought medical advice. And someone is requesting X-ray abdomen. This is the intrauterine contraceptive device. This one. Actually, this device was inserted 20 years ago, and the patient have 5 pregnancy and delivered. In spite of this device is around. By examination, she is vitally stable. And the abdominal organomegaly, mild tenderness in the lower abdomen. Ultrasound pelvic female was done, and the result came was normal because nothing in the uterus. And CT abdomen was done. This is a CT. This is a device. Here. Here.
What do you think? Where is the site here?
In the transverse column.
to make it short, it's there anyway. And in the colon, which part?
Transverse.
Huh? Hey. Okay. She has a chronic pain. She has a chronic pain for the last 10 years that nobody did know what's going on. And she was treated with ranitidine. No image was done. No. She get pregnant 5 times after that while she's in the intrauterine device. طيب. Last presentation, I don't know who did. Anyway, even this case didn't come to us. The patient came to the gynae, And they did, because of this chronic pain, once they saw this finding in the CT and the X-ray, they referred the case to the colorectal surgeon. By chance, I was with him in the room while he was scoping. And he did the sigmoid. He tried to go beyond the sigma, the splenic. He couldn't. So he took over just to finish that because we couldn't see anything. And the endoscopy, you can show the pictures now with the endoscopy. This is almost in the middle of the transfer score. It's embedded. It's No, the X-ray, everything. The case was referred to the surgeon. Referred to the surgeon as foreign body in the colon. And we were not consulted for this, but because I'm the one who finished the colonoscopy just to see what's going on there. And we found this one. No way. No way. Huh? It is looks, I mean, I don't know how to describe it. Like, you know the gastric band, if you see the gastric band, if it's penetrating the stomach sometimes, how stiff, how fibrous is it, and the tissue is, and it's hooking. I don't know what if there is any blood vessels on the other side, you cannot. The surgeon was wrong, but we decided not to touch it. It's quite fibrous and solid, even you cannot, it's quite fixed. No. The surgeon himself decided not to touch it. And the patient next day, she went to laparoscopic, and they cut this part and the re-anastomosis. I didn't follow the pathology after that. But you see the pictures, quite taking the whole diameter of the. I think it's sparing one of the part. I forget it. Do you have another pictures? I think no. There is a lot of pictures, not only this one. For us, no. We just in the literature, I reviewed in the literature. It is no. There is one I think in Europe. It presented in the Europe Journal of Gynecology Journal. And they said, but it was acute presentation for the patient. I mean, the patient had a ICD post-delivery after 1 month. And 7 months later, she came with the amenorrhea, and they found that she's pregnant. They did the ultrasound, and they found that the ICD was migrated to the sigmoid. And they diagnosed it with the transvaginal ultrasound, and they found that the device was there. They tried to remove it laparoscopically, but they found the sigmoid was perforated and converted to laparotomy. This is the reported case that was done, I think, is 2003. And this is what I know about this case.
We also saw one case, the last one, the patient was trusted the work and came out
of the okay. Sigmoid is the site, I think. But this patient was interesting for 10 years, I mean 20 years almost. And she got delivered, or she got pregnant five times, is it? Yeah. That's it. I think this is our cases for today. Ah. thank you for your attendance, and hopefully that you had a good cases. We have 10 minutes for the Jensen. I think they have something to be presented.